busy with some different things. It's not an excuse at all, it's just an explanation. Thank you for your patience. Choir, thank you for being here today on the Reign of Christ Sunday, the end of the Christian year. Today, we will entertain the last discourse of Jesus before his passion, which will reflect the first discourse of his ministry on the Mount, Sermon on the Mount. It's an exciting day. We look forward to doing justice. Now, next Sunday, the first Sunday of Advent, we will not be having services transmitted live, and nor will we be having Sunday school. I need to be out of town, and David has graciously consented to the fact that that would be all right, and I believe he's also therefore planning a trip and to Phoenix, I believe it is, and so we will not be having the first Sunday of Advent, so we'll be postponing our New Year's extravaganza special to the first Sunday of December, which will be the second Sunday of Advent. Excuse me. From time to time, I am coughing. The good news is that I'm not contagious. Bad news is I have this mound of junk right here that will not go up or down. And so it just tickles my throat until I have to cough. Good to see you. Glad that you survived the insular regimen. And, let's see. The announcements are in the bulletin. And are there other announcements for God's people today? Following the service, there is a spreads, fruits, and cookies, and apple juice with 7-Up. Hope that you'll take advantage of it for a few moments following the service. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, what excitement this season brings. Certainly, you've done it. Many times. The rituals may be set in stone, the expectations ripe, and the patterns already unrolling. But there is something about the season of Advent that brings forth the kid in us, and we learn and we lean into the hope. So let the excitement grow and let the buzz be felt. Now this is all about kind of foreshadowing next week and also completing this week. And so it is our great privilege to be lifted up on eagle's wings by the Provo Interfaith Choir under the direction of Mr. David Lewis, who will bring to us on eagle's wings. Thank you. needed that. I bet you turn your bulletin to the congregational call to worship. Dear friends, we come, for God gathers us here with that community called faith.
Where the hungry are served first, where the thirsty drink life's water.
We come, for God welcomes us here into that home called grace.
Where the naked are clothed in robes of hope, where the stranger is embraced as the long-lost prodigal.
We come, for God unites us here, sisters and brothers, in the family called love.
Where the imprisoned model justice, where the sick are cradled in God's peace.
Jesus wants us to be ready. The last several weeks we have been talking about pastoral responsibility. Pastoral responsibility is the responsibility that all Christians who have accepted the grace of God, who have accepted the forgiveness of God, are inclined to do, to be pastoral, to do acts in Christ's name. And in doing it in Christ's name, it's Christ himself who is doing it. And we want to be ready. Today we are talking about the return of Christ. In many denominations, Christian denominations, we're looking forward to that. The entrance into the perusal. Eternity. Will there be only light, no darkness? Will there be only joy, no sorrow? Will there be only hope, no confusion? In Matthew's gospel, the coming has already come. And he holds them in dynamic tension. Just like David holds this choir in dynamic tension. Four ranges somehow find harmony, even though each could stand on its own. When the time comes, when we are face to face, Jesus wants us to be ready. Ready for what? How do we keep our eyes open for the Christ who comes? Waiting to see him, waiting to receive him. So what are we doing to keep our lamps lit? Let us pray the Kyrie. For our slowness to recognize your gifts in other people and their calling to be children of God, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
For our reluctance to accept your free gifts and your gracious call to play our part in your ministry, Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
For any cause of division in your body for which we are responsible, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
We are sinners who know our Savior. We are acquainted with the one who has a solution to the brokenness of our souls. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Thank you.
Glory to God.
Amen. Amen. The bulletin indicates that we are going to be invited to stand. I invite you to remain seated as we sing the verses listed at the back of the hymnal, the four verses of Crown You with Riches Crowns. Now the title on the page is wrong. That's what we sang last week, but the words are correct. David?
Amen.
Lord, as the scriptures are read and the word proclaimed, open our hearts and minds to the power and movement of your Spirit, that we may see more clearly, understand more clearly, and be willing to respond more clearly. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, God's people say, amen. All right, we've already started. Matthew 25. Now, as I said earlier, this is the last public discourse in Jesus' ministry according to Matthew. Now, if you were to read Matthew, you would discover that Matthew does not mention the ascension. Mark does, Luke does, John. Matthew, no. As a matter of fact, what Jesus says is, go and make disciples, and I will be with you always. Understand the words. I will be with you always. Now, some millennia later, we have to interpret these words. And the most normal interpretation of these words is, he is with us in our heart. My parents are gone. They're with me in my heart. My grandparents are gone. They're with me in my heart. My soul and my mind and my strength. We don't forget them. We remember them. That was several weeks ago at All Saints Sunday. But that's not what Matthew is saying. Matthew is not saying, we'll have Jesus in our hearts, a nice sentimental touch. He is saying that Jesus is saying, I will be with you. Fascinating. How is that possible? Quite frankly, I have no idea. The church for millennia has been trying to bail Matthew out of this one, but there's just no bailing him out of it. He says what he means, and he means what he says. Jesus was dead, he rose, and somehow he's still with us. How is it possible to see Jesus? Well, first of all, I want to look right into your eyes and say, I can see Jesus in you. Now, you can look back at me, and you might be able to say, well, I think I see Jesus in you. Or you might be able to say, yes, I see Jesus in you. Or you can say, that makes no sense to me at all. You can look at each other. Will you see the presence of Jesus? The fancy word to say that is that when we were created out of Genesis 1, God says, in the image of God shall we create them, male and female. Now, it's in Genesis 2 that the man was created first and woman created second from man. But in Genesis 1, it says that the man and the woman were created equal and simultaneously. Wow, that must have been a hoot. So, God says, each of us have this. It's in our genetic DNA. We are made in the image of God. Therefore, we ought to be able to see God in each other. Now, can you see God in someone else? I bet you can. Now, can you see the devil in someone else? Can you see light in someone? Can you see darkness in someone? Pretty simple, isn't it? If you're looking. Okay, so you're walking down the street. You're walking in your business. Maybe you're walking in classrooms at school. How often do you look at the people? Most of the time, we look at them until we think they're going to look at us, and then we look away. What are we seeing? How are we judging them? By the clothes, by the gaze, by the look, all the above? How do we see God? We look for God. How do we see Jesus? We look for Jesus. Point two. Are you needy? Are you needy? needy person. Please don't shout the answer out. We couldn't take the answers. The fact is that all of us are needy. Every one of us. No matter how wealthy, no matter how poor, no matter how successful, no matter how much a failure, we all are needy. Question two, what do you need? Friendship, companionship, loyalty, care, concern, interest, money, health, what do you need? Jesus starts the Sermon on the Mount with the Beatitude, and he describes eight qualities of need. One of those needs is, blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall see God. How full is your spirit? And as soon as you understand how full it is, you can embrace how empty it is. 100% full? 100% empty. From a certain point of view. 99% full, 1% empty from a certain point of view. How wealthy are you? You can always be more wealthy. As soon as you understand your wealth, you now understand your poverty. There are professional athletes that have to be the highest paid athlete at their position or in the league in which they correspond. And as soon as they get rewarded, somebody's got to beat it because they see their poverty compared to the others. We don't like to think of ourselves as needy. We like to think of ourselves as having enough to give away or to share, or at least to support ourselves. So when the time comes for us to give away and to share, we can have sympathy for those who are less than we are. Those poor need. Poor thing. And that is part of our defensive mechanism so that we don't have to reckon with both our joy and our sorrow. That we can create this sincere delusion based on several words that says, it's not my fault. We want to build our psyche on this self-delusion, sincere delusion, excuse me, in which we said, it's your fault. I'm not responsible. So when we step out of the darkness, that's called darkness, when we step out of the darkness into the light, we say, I am responsible. And then we move from sympathy to something called compassion. Compassion literally means to suffer with. And instead of feeling sorry for someone and giving them something, we actually enter into their suffering. And invite them to enter into ours. The perfect couple. The perfect couple are exact opposites. Doesn't make a lot of sense, but that's just the way it works out. So when they are strong, they support my weaknesses. And when they are weak, I can support them with my strength. And it creates this marvelous homogeneity that we sometimes don't ever get over. As we compete with one another for who's more important or who's stronger. Or who needs to be submissive. Jesus solved that whole question when he, according to Paul, left heaven, left the riches of heaven, the glory of heaven, and took on the condition of a human being but didn't stop there and went on to take on the condition of a slave. It was Jesus who for 3 years entered into the misery of those who were looking for a shepherd to give them hope. He entered into the misery of those who lived by saying what I do, but not how I act. He entered into the sorrow, into the poverty. Into the spiritual poverty of a people who knew the two great commandments, love God, heart, soul, mind, strength, love your neighbor as you love yourself, and chose to ignore them. Except when he didn't take anything. He didn't bring anything. We don't know how in the world that they ate, but they must have because it lasted for 3 years. He went to places and he was welcome, and he went to places and he was run out of town. And we call him Savior. And he says, if you would be a disciple of mine, pick up your cross daily. Lord, can we have a second opinion on that? Pick up. Lord, I thought you called us to be special. I thought you called us to be leaders. And you're calling us to be servants like you are? Master, we're going to elevate you to the top level so that you will elevate us to the top level when you get elevated to the top level. Jesus says, that's not why we're here, boys. We're here to understand that God loves us with an unconditional love, and that in that love, we get to unconditionally love those who are not lovable, just like God loved you when you weren't lovable. But wait a minute, I'm a chosen person. Doesn't count that way. That's where we got off the rails. And so, what we set up here is darkness and light. Not two gods competing. Darkness and light, which are two choices that God offers us. The devil, Satan, darkness, father of lies, is not a god. The closest that he comes to being a god is like that serpent in the garden who comes and said, you're not going to die if you eat this fruit. God's not going to kill you. You don't have to take God seriously. How many times have people invited you to compromise who you are? How many times have you invited someone to compromise who they are? One of my favorite excuses for asking someone to compromise is, well, don't you love me? Think of it. I'm going to ask you to violate your core beliefs to prove that you love me. Sounds like darkness to me. So in the book of Revelation, the Antichrist has a number attached to his name. Number 666. You know who is 777? Jesus. The Lamb. God. You want to be on the side of 666? There's the desert. Go out and enjoy it. You want 777? Here's the garden. Come on in. Now, how do you know who gets to go to the desert and who gets to go to the garden? And Jesus says, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, all the angels will with him, then he will sit on the throne. Now, wait just a minute. Matthew, you just got through saying that Jesus is with us all the time, and now you say he's coming back. There's that dynamic tension I'm talking about. Theologically speaking, it's called the complementarity. Now all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another. Now the word nations here in the Greek means individuals who create families. Have you ever heard of the nation of Israel? You know who Israel is in the Old Testament? Of course you do. His name's Jacob. Now, ever heard of Edom? Of course you have. Edom is Esau, Jacob's brother. Ever heard of the Ishmaelites? That's the first son of Abraham. Ishmael. It's a whole nation. Ever heard of the Moabites? That's an incestuous son between Lot and his elder daughter. A whole nation. So when you're reading Matthew at this point, he's saying, when all the nations, when all the families have come together. And now he's speaking specifically of the families who know God. Not the families who don't know God. He's talking about the families who know God. Who have heard the covenant, I will bless you and you become a blessing. Who has understood the basics of Torah, which is love the Lord your God with heart, soul, mind, and strength, love your neighbor as you love yourself. Gather around. And he will separate one from another. Now, we're talking about sheep and goats here. I suppose that they're used to being separated. I don't know. Sopranos were over there. Why weren't the Sopranos over here? Matter of fact, why weren't the Sopranos all in? Because David separated them. Gee, was it hurtful? Was it harmful? Did you not like it? There's no instance here that the sheep and the goats didn't like it. But it's coming. See, just like Matthew says, has Jesus saying and embraces the second coming. But he's already here. That's another brain ticker. The reckoning's coming. And when the reckoning, when the judgment is, that's the coming. Whenever it happens. But anyway, that's another story. And he will put the sheep on his right hand, the goats on his left. Then the king will say to the one on his right hand, come, you're blessed. You're blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you. You've got the number 777. There's your entry into the garden. There's your entry into paradise. There's your entry into glory. For I was hungry, you gave me food. Thirsty, you gave me something to drink. Stranger, and you welcomed me. Naked, and you clothed me. Sick, and you took care of me. Prison, and you visited me. Wow. What a list. Now notice, it's not because they were faithful in obedience, it's not because that they had been baptized, it's not because they had accepted Jesus into their heart. It's not about faith. That's the first part of the formula. It's about the second part of the formula, neighborliness. That's the blessed to be a blessing. If you've done it unto the least of these, you've done it unto me. Hey, where? How's it feel to see an almost empty house? Well, we hope there's somebody watching live. Can you see the presence of God? Feel the presence of God with hardly anybody here? And of course, you're going to say, yes. It's not who we sing for, it's why we're singing. Anyway, it's just a thing. Lord, we didn't see you, but we did it to you. Yes, Jesus says you were compassionate. You had no sense of any reward except the joy of entering into their need. Fascinating. Then he will say to the one on his left hand, apart from me. Now they got the number 666 and they're pointing towards the desert. You are accused, depart from me, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For about 10 years in my ministry, I worked in deliverance ministries. And I worked on military bases to discover on military basis, there's a huge presence of Satan I talk to young children, teenagers, who had stood in the pentagram and taken the oath of darkness. I talk to teenagers who had become priests. I talk to young women who became pregnant so that they could deliver a child to be sacrificed on the altar of Satan minutes after its birth. I talked to two who were high priests who performed the rituals. One of the things that I learned about that cult was that they would entice someone in with all kinds of promises, and as soon as they had no more value, I read Matthew. That's what I'm reading here. The eternal fire is going to burn us up. Ego will burn us up. Loving only ourselves and not loving the neighbors of ourselves will burn us up. For I was hungry and you gave me nothing to drink, etc., etc. Lord, if we'd have just known it was you, we'd have done it. These will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. What side of the fence are you on? Today you get to decide, are you a sheep or a goat? And it's all based upon humanitarianism. Not sympathetic humanitarianism, that's 666, but compassionate humanitarianism, which is 7, 7, 7. Well, I can tell you that when you sang this morning, it was in Christ's glory. I could hear the angels, the choirs of angelic choirs of heaven singing with you. Could you? I could. And I saw glory on your face. Not the glory of 666, but the glory of 777. Were you kidding me? Were you funning me? Were you just pretending? I don't care. I saw it. And I saw and I felt the presence of God. God lifted me up, and I needed it. I had been down, I needed it. Gave it to me through you. In just a moment, we're going to have number two on the program, and that is, Then Sings My Soul. Now I'm waiting. I think that's the one with the big finale. Is that the one with the big finale? I'm waiting for it. Because when we're entering into righteousness, when we have heard the blessing, experienced the blessing, shared the blessing, we want to sing. We want to shout. We want to praise God. And not with words of damnation, but with words of blessing, with words of thanksgiving. A little bit ago this morning, I was really close to saying verbally, because I was saying them in my mind, to a caller who needed some clothes. A curse. Shouted at Joanne, shouted at anybody. I was put upon. I had things to do, places to go, and I was 10 minutes late getting it done here. Got a call. It's time for me to understand that in my need, I had forsaken. forsaken God. And now, I'm saying, Lord, thank you for forgiving me so that I can sing your glory. Well, we haven't solved the problem with Matthew. He still holds these in dynamic tension. But as we celebrate that complementarity, we will come to know something of God who lifts us to sing full throat and praise. All right, David, I'm confused. The postlude is not It Is Well With My Soul. It's you. Your plan is well with my soul. Okay. And the hymn of reflection, thankful, is the choir. All right. Thank you. Several months ago, as COVID entered into our lives and into the life of the church, so that we could not meet, one of the things that we had on our agenda was the dedication of our grand piano. We had had a grand piano that had much age on it. I'm not familiar with the story of how we got this piano, but I am confident that it is because of David. And whenever David is involved in these kind of things, brethren are involved in these kind of things. I wish I could tell you the story. Perhaps in the few moments following the service in the fellowship hall, you can ask. But one thing is sure, in the same way that we have new altar cloths, it is our custom to, at an appropriate time, dedicate these to the service of the church, the kingdom of God, and to the glory of God. At this time, it is my privilege to do just that. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have opened the windows of heaven and poured out upon us a great blessing. We were in need. And through your grace and through the generosity and through the work of your saints, we were bestowed with your blessing. Now, Lord, last week it was that high F that needed a little tuning. And I don't know, Lord, if that even got tuned, but I know that the piano sounds great to my ears and provides worthy accompaniment, as it provides a worthy blessing for those who play it and sing with it and are led by it. And so, Lord, cleanse us of all maladies, that we might in perfection and perfect peace offer to you this piano to your glory and in your service. For we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. The laying on of my hand. The church accepts this gift and calls it blessing, that it may be used to the service of God and to the glory of God. And until it be discommissioned, must always be used for that purpose. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, those who are in agreement and will so dedicate this instrument along with me, signify by saying, Amen,
amen.
And amen.
Amen.
It is done. Comes now a time for joys and concern. We have any this week? Holy God, we bow in prayer today on behalf of strangers and friends who stand in need of prayer. Lord, for the gentleman who called from the hospital today in need, thank you for helping him find our number. And as we are able to provide for his need, Lord, in humility, we offer it in your name. We thank you for the gift and now the dedication of this piano, consecrated to you, O Lord. We pray for the reign of Christ, the end of the year and the beginning of the new year, for the seamless transition. We pray from our heart to your heart, Lord, for those whose names and situations are known only to us, as we offer them now to you. Thank you, Lord. We pray for our country, our state, and our cities. We pray for Utah and Salt Lake counties and the surrounding counties that continue to relapse into COVID. We pray for rain and snow to curb the drought and to provide for a healthy spring. We pray for the areas devastated by forest and mountain fires. Pray for renewal. We pray for our city and our state and our country as entering the final days of the election season. We pray for the members of this congregation. We pray for the Provo Interfaith Choir, and especially thank you that they have chosen this choir to raise their voices to your glory. Lord, we recognize you as a God of mercy and compassion. We come to you this morning saying, what is the offering that pleases you most? Certainly not the token gifts that make us feel well done, all that is required, but a gift that reminds us that need is all around us and compassion and love are needed desperately and can be given, extracted. As we offer our lives today, as we offer our monetary gifts today, as we offer our gifts, the gifts that we give through your church, may that which we contribute feed the hungry, clothe the naked, give a cool water of drink to the thirsty, care for the imprisoned. And Lord, in so doing, may our whole being be centered on seeing you and those opportunities to personally make your love real to a hurting world, as if we are making it real to you. With confidence, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who himself taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Save us in the time of trial. Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Is this in choir, please? bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Depart from this place with the assurance that God is with you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And God's people say, amen. And amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.